invite you to stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In holy baptism, Larry was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all his sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in the death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in the resurrection like his." I invite you to speak Psalm 23 responsively with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Larry and to all your servants who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our Old Testament lesson is from Psalm 91. I chose this psalm because it served as the basis for the hymn on Eagle's Wings, which was the one song that Larry definitely wanted sung. And it's a beautiful psalm, and I think we'll read it responsibly. I'll begin with the first verse, and then you'll read the second verse, and we'll alternate on Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence.
He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a buckler.
You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day,
nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday.
A thousand may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked.
Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge,
no evil shall be allowed to follow you, no plague will come near your tent.
For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways.
On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone.
You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot.
Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him, I will protect him, because he knows my name.
When he calls to me, I will answer. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him.
With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson chosen for our comfort and our consolation is from 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, beginning with the 6th verse. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the Hallelujah verse. Alleluia, Alleluia. Jesus Christ is the firstborn of the dead.
To him be glory and power forever. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our Christian faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word that I want to direct your attention to this morning for your comfort, your consolation, and your peace is from 2 Timothy chapter 4, was the second scripture reading, and I could read once again verses 6 to 8. I have finished the race, I have fought the good fight, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. So far, the word of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, your family, and especially you, Gail, and Aaron, and Jennifer, God's peace and his comfort be yours. We are gathered here this morning for the funeral service of Larry, as we remember his life, as we grieve his death, but as we especially celebrate that he has received the crown of life that the Apostle Paul speaks about here in our text. There is certainly sorrow and grief at the loss of a loved one that kind of wells up within our heart. But Jesus himself shed tears at the graveside of Lazarus, a good friend, the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. And he cried after his good friend Lazarus had died. Jesus knows what tears are, he knows what sorrow is, and he identifies with us. But as the Apostle Paul reminds us, we grieve, but not as those who have no hope, because our grief is mingled with the sure and certain hope that we have in Christ Jesus, our Savior, who died, yes, but who rose again. God's word, then, is our only hope, our source of comfort. We don't need man's word, we don't need philosophies, we don't need thoughts, but we need God's word, which is true and reliable. Along with the disciples, we ask the question, Lord, to who shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. He has the words of comfort in the face of death. And so, the words that I have chosen are the language of victory. Always appropriate for the death of a Christian. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith, and there is laid up for me that crown of righteousness which Christ, the righteous judge, will give to me on that last day. These words that were written by the Apostle Paul, who uses a couple of athletic analogies here, I have fought the good fight. Perhaps he was referring to the Greco-Roman wrestling that took place in the Olympics. He says, I've fought a good fight. I've run the race, maybe the marathon, that long-distance run that was also run already from the time of the Apostle Paul in the Roman Olympics, the Greek and Roman Olympics. And I would suggest that Larry had a couple things in common with the Apostle Paul. First, they both knew they were going to die. I find that an interesting connection. Paul writes here, I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. He was writing to, he was referring to his own death. He wrote this to a young pastor, Timothy. He was in prison. He knew it was the last days of his life. He was even facing martyrdom. Perhaps he would be thrown to the lions in the Roman circus for the entertainment of the crowds. He knew that was going to happen shortly. But he knew his death was imminent. And I would suggest the same thing for Larry. After his official diagnosis, he knew his life on this earth was very short, just a matter of days. And he lived out each day as much as he could, appreciating those days that God did give him. But really, that's how we all need to live. Really. One day at a time, each day. Because none of us really knows when that last day will come. And so that's the proper way for every Christian to live. And so for Christians, death is not the end, but as Paul says here, it's a departure. Interesting word, isn't it? In other places, I have a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. That's how he referred to his own death that he faced. It's a departure. But even more importantly than knowing that death is imminent, both Paul and Mary, the apostle, they knew death was short and it was coming. But more importantly, they both were ready. And that's really important. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness. In the New Testament, there are two different words used for crown. And the one is a royal crown, a crown, a golden crown that a king would wear. The other is stephanos, which would be the laurel wreath, that kind of a crown, which was given to the victorious athlete in competition, kind of like an Olympic gold medal. And that's the crown Paul's talking about. This crown, this laurel wreath, this victory crown that the Lord, his righteous judge, would give him. Our brother Larry has fought the fight. He has run the race. He's kept the faith. Or maybe more precisely, we should say, the Holy Spirit has kept him in the faith. And for that, we rejoice and give thanks. I count it a blessing that as his pastor, even while the vacancy pastor, I was able to come and visit with Larry while he was still lucid. And I was able to give him the sacrament, the Holy Communion, just a tiny piece of bread, because he wasn't able to eat much, dipped in that wine. But as the Lord reminds us that in, with, and under that bread and wine is the very body and blood of Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And so Larry had the assurance that his sins indeed were forgiven by his Savior. And that meant that he was ready to depart. The Lord gave him that body broken on the cross, that precious blood shed from those holy veins for his assurance that his sins were forgiven. Whenever I ask you as a family to share something about Larry, one of the things that always rose to the top was that Larry was a perfectionist. And all of you had that experience. He wanted to do the best possible work, the highest quality. And he was a perfectionist, but Larry was not perfect, was he? He was a sinner like every one of us. Every human being, we fall short of the glory of God. In fact, the prophet Isaiah said, all our righteousness is like a filthy rag. And Paul, in another place, says, there is none righteous, not even one. That's why all of us desperately need the perfect righteousness of Christ in order to stand before God. And that's why it's such good news that by God's grace, Jesus freely offers us his perfect righteousness. That's the righteousness that we see through faith in Christ. That's the righteousness that St. Paul speaks of here. That's the righteousness that Larry received by God's grace. And for that we thank and praise the Lord. You know, it's not ever easy when you lose a loved one, any time of year. Sometimes it's even more difficult around a holiday, like, well, Thanksgiving, because we're in this Thanksgiving weekend. But I think it's appropriate for us as Christians to, in any situation, even at the death of a loved one, to think of all the things that we can thank God for. And I think that's a helpful practice. And certainly as we think of Larry, we think of the many blessings bestowed upon him during his earthly life, beginning with his baptism down there in Nebraska, where he became a child of God through the water and word of baptism. That he was protected throughout his life. That Psalm 91 that we just read, you know, he'll give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. They will bear you up so that you don't strike or put against a stone. And Larry certainly saw the protecting hand of God in his life. He shared with me that when he was drafted, he went to boot camp, and he was preparing to go to Vietnam, and then at the last minute, there was an intervention that said, Larry, you're not going to Vietnam. You're going to go to Washington, D.C. and be part of the old guard. And he saw that as the Lord's hand protecting him so they didn't have to go to Vietnam. And so that he was thankful for that. I was kind of amazed, and as I think about, I probably have more relationship with Larry than anybody else here in the last 2 years. He said he was the head elder. And he got best pastors, he got organists. We had many conversations. I remember sitting down when I first was asked to be vacancy pastor, and we were agreeing to conversation and so forth. And I said, well, do you think we should put anything in writing? And he said, no, this is, you know, our word is good enough. Let's go on a gentleman's agreement. His word was good. And I kind of appreciated that. I really did. And I'm thankful for that. I was amazed, and I'm thankful as his vacancy pastor, that he and I had common experience one that I would have never dreamed of. But he went to that little one-room school in Millbrook, Nebraska. And lo and behold, 5 years later, I attended that same one-room school in Millbrook, Nebraska, that one little Lutheran school. And I remember we played on the same ball field. We hit the ball into the cemetery, which was right next to the school. We were chasing balls around the cemetery. He did it 5 years before me. One thing that I really remember about Larry is he helped with ushering. He was a fast walker and a fast talker. We would take communion to the back, to Kayleen on the organ, or one of our someone was in a wheelchair. And then we would come back to the altar, and I'm 6 years younger than he was, and I could hardly keep up with him. I was winded by the time I got to the altar. And so that was a challenge. But there's a lot of things that we can be thankful for. I know he was thankful for growing up at the resort. He said, how could any kid have more fun? And he learned so many things at the resort. He made friendships. He shared a deal with me, the boys, the cranks they pulled and the fun they had. He worked hard. He learned how to work hard. And thank God for that. Work is a blessing also. But he also knew how to have some fun. I think that's maybe where he gained his interest in people. The guests at the resort, he would visit, and he was open to listening. And I know one other thing he was thankful for, because he told me, and he was thankful that the two of you, Aaron and Dale, you're going to work on the business. That gave him great comfort. He was thankful for that. And so God be with you as you pursue that. We all have memories that we can be thankful for. You have good memories of how your dad helped you with fix-em-up projects, Jennifer, and all of those things. A blessing of the Lord. And so on this Thanksgiving weekend, we give thanks to God for all those blessings, freely given. But Larry was blessed by God to be a blessing to others. Even as God calls each of us. He blesses us with gifts, and he wants us to be a blessing to others. Today we especially thank God that by his grace, Larry has fought a good fight. He has finished the race. But you and I, you know what? We're still fighting a good fight. We are still in the race, this race of life. And we still battle with sin. And frustration, and disappointment, and grief, and all kinds of things. The Apostle Paul met with furious opposition to his preaching of the gospel. That's why he was in prison when he wrote this. He was in prison awaiting death. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory. You know, Paul had that famous thorn in the flesh. We don't know what it was, but it was something that afflicted him that he felt was preventing him from fully carrying on his work as a missionary. And he prayed three times, Lord, if it's your will, take this thorn from me. And you know what God's answer was? No, Paul. My grace is sufficient for you because my strength is made perfect in your weakness. God's grace is sufficient for each of us. Yes, even in our weaknesses, because his strength shines through our weakness. We have one who has won the victory. That's our Lord Jesus Christ, who died, yes, but who rose again for us, victorious over death. He is the only one that has the answer to death. And in him we find comfort and joy and peace, and we look forward to that crown of life that the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to us on that last day. Jesus wore a crown of thorns so that you and I might wear that crown of righteousness. And so once again, hear these words one final time, these reassuring words from the Apostle Paul. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. May God grant that for each of us. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may that peace of God, which surpasses all of our human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us stand for prayer. Let us pray to the Lord, our God and Father, who raised Jesus from the dead. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and so pass with him through the gate of death and the grave for our joyful resurrection. Grant that all who have been nourished by the holy body and blood of your Son may be raised to immortality and incorruption, to be seated with him at your heavenly banquet. Give to the family of Mary and to all who mourn comfort in their grief and assure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Give courage and faith to the bereaved, that within the communion of your church they may have strength to meet the days ahead, in the assurance of a holy and certain hope, and in a joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love who have departed in the faith. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Receive our thanks for Larry and for all the blessings you bestowed on him in this earthly life. Bring us at last to our heavenly home, that with him we may see you face to face in the joys of paradise. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray together the prayer that our Lord has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Lord, now in death your servant holding peace, your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, our shepherd, you gather the lambs of your flock with the arms of your mercy, and you bring them home. Comfort us with a certain hope of the resurrection to everlasting life, and a joyful reunion with those we love who have died in the faith. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name
of the Lord. Amen. We sing our closing hymn, Now Thank You All Our God.